Yeah, they are best known for Two Gun Bob. It's an autobiographical strip that runs in every issue of Dark Horse Comics, Robert E. Howard related comic books. And over here on my right is Mark Schultz. As I was telling you earlier, he did Wandering Stars and Del Rey's cover art and interior art for The Coming of Conan. And he's best remembered for Xenozoic Tales, which was... Yeah.
Wait. Oh, girl. Come on, you guys are.
It was a great comic. I really enjoyed reading it way back when. And a cartoon and a lunch kettle, right? Yeah. Well, everything. One day we're gonna have a Xenozoic Tales Pulp Fest, maybe 100 years. I don't think I'll be around for that.
And he's now writing Prince Valiant.
Okay, so John's getting the projector ready and we'll get started in a moment. This is a presentation on Conan through the decades, a look at all the various illustrators who have drawn the Robert E. Howard's wonderful creation.
Hi, how's that sound?
Good.
Good? Okay.
I think this whole thing was just a trick to keep us away from the cake.
Yes.
Driving the bar.
Can't have the cake too.
Exactly. Can't have the cake and our slideshow. One of the best ways to kind of cause controversy among Robert E. Howard fans, besides putting more than one of them in a room at a time, would be to ask them who their favorite Robert E. Howard illustrator is, or what their favorite Howard illustration is. So the other night, when we were talking among ourselves, we asked ourselves that question, and the picture on the screen right here was Mark's answer. So why don't we start with Mark, and he can kick this off first.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
pardon us while we eat. It's kind of hard to dispute that the man who had the most visual impact in bringing, I think, Howard to the masses is Frank Frazetta. And the question is always just which Frank Frazetta image do you choose? This particular image for me, it's a tough one, it's a close one, but it had the elements of mystery that I felt that Frazetta did so well at his peak period, starting with the great creepy covers he did, eerie covers, right through the Lancer paperback. There's not only a sense of that brutal power that he brings so well to images, but there's also that sense of hidden horror, half-seen mystery in this piece. And again, this piece just kind of epitomizes that, those qualities that made his work so strong, I believe. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Now, with Mark's piece, we chose the paperback cover because, you know, he was of the generation that actually was able to buy those paperbacks. Ruth and I were not. So we just wanted to get that straight up front. So I think we saw these images for the first time in those Berkeley collections that they did, or Valentine, I guess, the art of Frank. So, and this is Ruth's choice.
Yes. So this is, you know, still on Frazetta, and I couldn't think of anyone else that had ever done, you know, really nailed it. Other people have gotten, you know, the details, describing the text better, things like that, but nobody's captured that essence of Conan better than Frazetta did. And, you know, way before I knew anything about Conan or Howard, I saw these Valentine collections, and I remember seeing this piece, and it just really striking me. It's so iconic, you know, it has this kind of, you know, old master's composition, this pyramidal composition, and I'm just like, really, you know, I was looking at all the, you know, the way he did the skin, you know, the burnished skin of Conan and the soft white skin of the girl, purple or blue tinge, and just really caught up with all these things. And then it was about, you know, and that was, you know, a long time ago. And then it was like last year, and I looked at the piece, I was like, wow, look, there's like a skull in the background. I've never seen that before. So there's so much to see in his work, whether you're looking at the details, you're looking at the big picture, you're looking at the color, you're looking at the composition, it's all there.
And then this might be, it started to become obvious when I picked my favorite, that all three of us obviously went with Frank. And there wasn't really a second choice. None of us were looking elsewhere. And when we started thinking about doing the history of Howard illustration, we realized that Frazetta looms so huge over Howard illustration that you can't get away from it. There's whatever was done before Frank and whatever was done after. But Frank is definitely, artistically speaking anyway, the turning point. And it's... you're in his shadow if you're going anywhere near Conan since then. And, you know, for me, when I saw that when I was about 13 or something, yeah, it has all the same kind of things that I loved in Jack Kirby's art, and just an image that explodes off the page with fury. And as I've, you know, become over the years more familiar with Howard and been researching his work in life, it just seemed to sum up a certain part of what Howard wrote in those stories. So we started looking back through some of the other art that's been done and realized that almost everybody in modern illustration, genre illustration, has touched on Conan at some point. And a lot of guys would pick Buscema as one of their favorites because of the great work he did at Marvel. And was this something that you were reading at the time? Were you aware of this?
Yeah, I was following Marvel in the comics. As well. I mean, Conan, Marvel, you got Conan in Marvel comics, yes.
And the next one is Barry Smith, another, you know, fan favorite, and a kind of a different direction for all of the post-Frazetta artists. He did not seem to have quite as much of Frazetta's influence. You were talking about...
Yeah, so Winsdor-Smith is interesting because he came from a very... whole different direction. He was very influenced by the pre-afterlifes and very influenced by British art traditions. In many ways, counter to the very American tradition of what Howard was doing with his writing. So it's a standout, kind of a unique take on Howard that never really led to much of a direction after that. He was a very standalone individual.
But so we started looking for some examples of who had been involved in some way with Conan. We found almost everyone, and sometimes they're the guys you'd expect. Jeffrey Jones did this cover, and I hadn't been aware that he'd ever painted Conan. I knew he did a bunch of other Howard characters. The next up here is Bernie Wrightson, who did this was a poster during his... association with he was releasing a bunch of posters at the time, and this was his Conan poster. And both Jones and Wrightson seemed kind of obvious. But then the next one here is Alex Toth, who it was hard to imagine Toth drawing Conan. And most people, if you're not familiar with his work, he's most famous as the designer of the Super Friends cartoon. On television, he got involved with Hanna-Barbera, but he did an amazing amount of great comic work. And also Jack Kirby did this Conan pinup. And I don't think this ever went beyond a pencil stage except in Kirby fanzines after his passing. We found a piece by John Byrne, who became a fan favorite in the 80s, though I don't think he ever drew Conan in one of the Marvel comics, just a pinup or two. And more recently, Mike Mignola, who's the creator of Hellboy, he is a huge Robert E. Howard fan and was looking forward to getting a chance to do some comics for Dark Horse because he said Conan was the one influence he never really figured out a way to get into Hellboy. he poured everything else he liked in there, from Bride of Frankenstein, straight on through all those Marvel monster comics, but he couldn't. He said he never really figured out how to work in Conan.
He's so. Certainly a lot of Lovecraft.
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, he's such a fan. Neil is such a fan of the pulps and all those old authors, and he could go on at length about any of them. And, Smith and Machen and M.R. James, all that stuff. He's just nuts for it.
And Bill Sienkiewicz was someone that I was really surprised to have seen. He seems completely out of left field for doing a Conan illustration, but he had also done Conan. And the next one is Wally Wood did this cover for one of the pastiches that Nyberg and DeCamp did. So if you're going over the number of artists that have done these things, there's an awful lot to choose from in terms of what your favorite is. And you might not find a lot of agreement there, but we can all agree on what the worst Conan drawing is. I don't think it gets any worse than this cover of Conan. I think Mark was pretty appalled that I actually included this. So we came back to Frazetta and realized that Frazetta made the seems significant contribution in somehow putting brush to canvas for bringing Howard's words to life. There's one other.
I just like to just present in Howard's relationship is kind of like last night, if anyone was here for the St. John talk that I'm sorry, David, I drew on the blank, I'm sorry, Gabe, the fact that it's hard to divide the popularity of St. John and Burroughs apart from each other. They both reinforced each other's popularity. And I think the same can be said of Frazetta and Howard. In Howard, Frazetta got the perfect material that he could sink his teeth into and really created defining images. And at the same time, Frazetta's the paperback covers really added to the enormous popularity that Howard underwent in the 60s. So it's a nice symbiosis when illustration is working well with material. Everyone benefits, and it's a great symbiosis.
This picture, this isn't the Conan Howard ever do. I mean, it's what we all immediately think of as Conan, because Frank just, he kicked the door in when he did these pieces. But Howard himself never saw this kind of work. For Howard, this was the depiction of Conan that he got to see from artists, and it's quite a lot, a departure from what Frank was doing. This is Margaret Brundage and one of her original Weird Tales covers. And this Conan, I don't know that he has a lot in common with what Frank was doing, really. It's a different mindset. Her influences were completely different, so she's coming out of a different place.
Well, it's a different aesthetic entirely. What she was trying to get across wasn't the same thing that Frazetta tried to get across.
But this is the very first Conan drawing ever done. This is drawn by Jan Wilcox, and it was December 1932, Weird Tales. It's kind of got a Roman quality about it. I don't think any of us today would leap to picture Conan in that skirt there.
But it's not necessarily too far from what Howard actually wrote.
No, and that's the thing. These here are pictures from the Red Nails when it ran in Weird Tales. And again, this is probably closer in some ways to what Howard wrote, but we just picture something different. This here is Hugh Rankin. This was Howard's favorite artist that did his Weird Tales work, and Howard was collecting these originals. He would write to the editor and asked if he could have the originals that ran with his story, and he wrote to friends and talked about how he was pasting these together on a board at home and hoped to make a large display for himself. And he felt that by far Rankin was the weirdest of all the Weird Tales artists, that he actually captured some of the strangeness that Howard was trying to put into the stories.
Yeah, I mean, this guy, Weird Tales doesn't have, like most of the pulps, does not have a long history of great interior artists, but this guy really rose above the norm and truly weird individualistic stuff. And he incorporated, wonderful designer too, he was incorporating the lettering of the titles into the art.
And this title here, you know, in terms of it being relevant, I was hired to design this logo for Fantastic Worlds of Robert E. Howard, and just trying to find a style of text that worked well for Howard. People always tend to go for this sort of a heavy metal album cover look, but I went back and looked at what Rankin had done, and I loved that little treatment on the letters with the etchings. So I ended up just swiping that concept, and it seemed to fit well with Howard. And then shortly after this here, I ended up kind of biting from the same thing again to do the design for a Rehupa logo for a Rehupa mailing zine, Red Ruin. And it was that logo that came to the attention of Marcelo Anciano at Wandering Star, and then he hired us to do design for the Wandering Star Library because he thought these captured the sort of thing he was looking for in Howard as well. I find it interesting that by going back to the earliest sources, we were kind of able to tap into at least some idea of what they were after in publishing pure text Howard, and he saw the logos as being kind of, bringing that. So this is a 1953 Kelly Freeze cover, and still a little more barbaric, I think, than what Margaret Brundage was doing, but still a much less fierce, I think, Conan than we would be used to today. And up next is another Romanesque Conan from that series, and this is Edward M. Schmeller, and this was on the following year in 54. And when you look at these things, again, I wonder, would that character, would he have been enough to capture anyone's attention when they were using that concept at Marvel? I don't picture him selling those Lancer paperbacks.
Well, there wasn't a distinctive look yet. It was kind of generic.
And you're not going to get inside the book unless the cover makes you want to open it. And Howard's words were always the same, but I kind of wonder if something like this was selling the work inside as much. But everything comes back to Frazetta, and you start realizing what a huge contribution he made to what we even think of as Conan. When you read the stories, it's a little hard not to somehow have a part of this in your head. But you also, one of the things about Frank's work is he was only doing covers. Frank was not in illustrating the interiors of the books. And that was a job that you were given a bunch of Conan stories to illustrate. And we illustrated a couple when we did the Best of Robert E. Howard. But Conan isn't always doing that. If you go back one, Conan isn't always killing people. And if you have to illustrate a book where the picture sits directly next to the text, and the text is describing something different, another part of Conan's personality, it's a little tough sometimes to make this pitiless man that Frank painted work in that context. But at the same time, you can't escape it entirely. And when Gary Gianni was illustrating his Conan book, I remember him saying that he had gotten the advice from someone that he would never be able to outdraw Frank, but he might be able to outthink him because he had a broader canvas on which to work. It didn't have to be a cover. It didn't have to sell the book. It didn't have to grab you instantly. And so he was able to do, clearly there's a little bit of Frazetta in his concept there, but Gary's Conan was able to be quieter and more brooding. He didn't have to be fighting a gorilla, and he had to find a new side of the character to illustrate something that maybe hadn't been thought of before. But I found it interesting that he did have to, I think, artistically acknowledge the vocabulary established by Frank Frazetta. This isn't a Romanesque Conan. It isn't a completely antique look at him. It does reflect a little of what Frazetta did, but I think it's a new take on that idea. Oh yeah, well that's I don't. If you haven't read this story, this is Which Shall Be Born, right? And in this story, Conan is a soldier working for this Sultan guy here, and at this moment in the story, the guy in the turban still thinks he's in charge. And Gary did a great job in his storytelling here by showing you what's essentially about to happen in the story is that guy's going to learn who the army's actually fighting for. And he does an almost biblical thing, how he bathes Conan in that light behind him, drawing you to his glowering darkness there. He's relaxed, non-threatening, really, but you can tell that something's bottled up, and when it comes out, it's going to be more than you're going to be able to cope with. And Gary was drawing a lot on Orientalist paintings that had been done, trying to, with the rich fabrics and the golds and, basically all the bling the bad guy there is wearing, to try to tap into some of the Middle Eastern flavor that a lot of Howard's stories have. He describes minarets and things. And if you see the Hollywood movies, they often have everyone dressed like they're basically a caveman. But that's not, Howard never really described that. I find it funny in some of them how everyone looks primitive, and yet when Conan walks in the room, they immediately know he's the barbarian in the movies. And I'm not sure what gives them away, but that's not really the world Howard wrote about. And I
just want to say, notice too, this is really clever. Something Gary did here is there's just a little view between the curtains, looking outside to see the army, just a portion of the vast army we know of outside. But he places that army right over Conan, right behind Conan, so we get the impression that that army, whether or not the Sultan knows it yet, the army is behind Conan. Just enough of a psychological edge there.
Yeah, because this guy has mistakenly thought they were fighting for him, but Conan is actually the general leading them into all their victories, and Conan knows that those men fight for him. And he's about to take over the entire army, and dispatch this fellow. But sometimes, I'll let you talk about this in a moment too, in terms of some of the strange things that are in the book. But this is a painting by Greg Manchess, and this is a painting of Conan that you would never, you wouldn't look at that and say, oh, that's Conan. But Howard often described Conan somewhat like this, that Conan often liked to wear really nice clothes, silks and breeches and jackets. And he was a warrior who did a lot of stealing, and he did it because he liked to live right and took a lot of advantage of that. But you were talking about some of the problems.
Do you want me to go all negative here?
I'd
be interested in people's opinion, though. Now, this is one of the problems I have with Howard. Now, believe me, I don't have many problems with Howard, but he would, in his stories, he would mix technology and costuming from many different ages. He would have knights with armor that was as advanced as the 15th or 16th century going into battle with ancient Egyptian archers. Which I've said this to many people, it's like putting a Sherman tank against a caveman. It's not going to be a real battle. I have trouble with, he wore rich silks, but should they be like the rich silks of a 17th century gentleman? For me, it pulls it out of the reality a little too far. And I have trouble, as much as I love this as a painting, I have trouble myself regarding this as a Hyborian. It pulls it out of the context of the world that Howard created.
Right, and that's one of that's one of the bold choices of Manchus as the illustrator of the book, is that I don't know his familiarity with the Howard prior.
I don't believe Manchus knew anything about Conan prior to illustrating the book. I don't think he had seen the movies or read the books. So he had only the text to go by.
His speciality is his text interpretation in terms of, he's a very regular artist for the National Geographic. So he's called upon a lot to create a picture based on, these are photographs of these artifacts, and this is a description of what the environment was at that time. And so he's used to doing all that stuff and turning it into a picture to give us a visual presentation. And I think when he read the Conan text, he wasn't thinking of it in terms of, this doesn't look like Conan, because, for those of us who know Conan mostly through Frazetta and those that came after Frazetta, the image of Conan has been codified. Well, he's got, hair down to here, and he's got the earrings, and he's got the belt, and he's got this, that, and the other. And for all of us that do that, have done these illustrations, it's kind of always there for us. Well, we have to put, X, Y, and Z in, so everybody knows who Conan is in, which one is Conan in the scene. Because you don't always have the choice of, the biggest guy or the guy with the sword or whatever, that one is Conan. So you kind of create this, even unconsciously, I think, we create these visual
vocabulary
to establish that. But for Craig, that wasn't there for him at all. So if Howard's going to describe him whether it's a specific wardrobe thing that doesn't have anything to do with the, what's actually going on in whatever period he's trying to, necessarily historically copy, but give us a sense of the buccaneering days, Manchester's looking at, he's supposed to be a buccaneer, so that's what he's saying. He's not saying, I can't put that hat on, because that is not working at all for Conan. He's just going,
because he didn't bring any baggage to it. So it was an interesting take to see an artist who really was entirely unfamiliar with what was supposed to be done.
It looks more like Conan and Treasure Island.
Yeah, it does.
It is an accurate painting.
Yeah, a description. Yeah.
Right, and that's what I was saying. Manchus only had Howard's words to go by. He hadn't seen the Marvel comics. He hadn't seen anything. So I found that really interesting, because it's almost like going back to those earlier illustrations where he's doing it without having the hindsight of going, Conan wears that bear pelt and he's drawn by John DeSima, and it's just he hadn't seen it. He didn't know about it.
That's just how rich illustration is. Illustration is not, it's not the gospel, it's not the word, it's not the text. It's an interpretation by an individual artist, and it's a cool thing. There can be a ton of different interpretations.
And a lot of times when we talk to, comics fans, especially at San Diego or something, they'll come up and they'll praise one thing or kind of say they didn't like another, and they'll often say, that's not how I pictured it. And, well, that's the thing, I have no way of knowing how you pictured it. Everybody has to find their own voice for something. And if you go to the next one, I wanted you to, Mark, talk about this. These are your earliest sketches, I think, as you were trying to find your Conan.
Yeah, when I got the assignment for doing the Wandering Star Conan book, which encompassed the first third of Howard's chronological output of Conan, as Jim alluded to, you got to try to find your own space in the face of the overwhelming presence that Frazetta has laid over over the field power illustration. So I tried to come up with a look to Conan that, again, given that I was doing illustrations, not simply a cover illustration that was had to serve as kind of the embodiment of the, single embodiment of what is most memorable maybe about Howard, or most salable, let's put it that way. The fact that Howard wrote, he wrote him as a brutal killer, but he also wrote him as a very charismatic leader. Here's a guy who came from nothing, and he ended up ruling an empire. And you don't do that just by being a brutal killer. You do that by winning people's hearts and minds. So I had just seen very recently, before I started Deep, I'd seen the movie Gladiator with Russell Crowe. And for me, Gladiator is probably the best non-Howard Howard movie ever made. But the look in Russell Crowe's eyes, his presence in front of his men was this calming, yet very intense, very electric presence. And I tried to capture that in my depiction of Conan, in my the countenance of this man that was able to be both a ruthless killer and a leader of men.
And I remember you saying at the time that trying to find your niche in it, to get your own handle on the character, that you felt like, others might have captured, like Frazetta had captured the energy or whatever, but no one had ever captured Conan's intelligence. And that's something that you felt you could do, and you were really drawn to about the character, and that native intelligence.
Enormous stuff. The guy picked up languages left and right throughout his career. He mastered all sorts of disciplines. And in the end, it was the first story that Howard wrote, The Phoenix and the Sword, but it was the last story chronologically, right? I mean, not that he wrote it chronologically, but in the life of Conan that Howard wrote.
Howard the Dragon, I think.
Oh, the Hour to Drag. Okay, but it's still close to the, relatively speaking, end of his career.
Right.
He's turned from this teenager who kills a man who insults him to this guy who almost risks his own life to support the arts. He doesn't want to kill a poet. That's an incredible character evolution for any serial character. And it bespeaks the intelligence that Howard wrote into the character. I tried to capture that somewhere in this version of Conan.
And then looking back at what was happening artistically in Howard's life, he lived in an age of the golden age of American illustration, really, and just an age of heroes and the best of the best. This is N.C. Wyeth, and N.C. was the king of adventure illustration. And this here is J.C. Leyendecker's brother, Frank. This was just done for an average magazine in the 1920s. And so this kind of strongman thing, this here was published 1 year to the month before Howard introduced Conan in Weird Tales. And it's Tarzan, of course, but it's got that, it's got a certain, that Conan thing. Think of that Frazetta painting that I picked, where he's on the pile of men with his axe behind his head. It, it's all part of that same artistic lineage.
And you see that again and again throughout the hall. I mean, any of you that have been flipping through the pulp boxes see, tons of Blue Book and that whole era. I mean, all pulps are concerned with heroics, either the sinister variety, or the flat outright heroics, whether it's English heroes or primitive heroes or frontier heroes or whatever.
Now this here is the cover of the Weird Tales, December 32, that Conan was introduced in, and even though this isn't a Conan illustration on the front by J. Allen St. John, it shows you that there was definitely something in the water at that moment, because it could be a Conan illustration practically. And so Conan doesn't come out of nowhere, thematically speaking, necessarily. There was a lot of this sort of fantastic, heroic adventure happening. But Howard had a slightly different take, and you have to go beyond just the artists. That's not the only thing. It may have been one of the things influencing him, but it wasn't the only thing. In a letter to Clark Ashton Smith that Howard wrote in 1935, describing his creation of Conan. He said, some mechanism in my subconsciousness took the dominant characteristics of various prize fighters, gunmen, bootleggers, oil field bullies, gamblers, and honest workmen I have come in contact with, and combining them all produced the amalgamation I call Conan the Cimmerian. I think very large in Howard's creation of Conan are a lot of real men of the day. We've got Jack Dempsey here. Howard was a huge Jack Dempsey fan and followed his career and wrote about him often in letters and poetry. Harry Houdini, who was another famous muscle man of the period and all of his famous escapes. And a lot of times you see some of these Houdini-esque themes even turning up in Conan, people being chained into, cells and whatnot. This is Eugene Sandow, who was the bodybuilder of the early 20th century. And Douglas Fairbanks, who I think if they had made a Conan movie in the 20s, might have ended up playing Conan, and we know that Howard was a big fan of this kind of thing. In the silent movies, Fairbanks definitely represented the same kind of swashbuckling adventure hero that Howard was writing partially about, and I think especially Thief of Baghdad here was something that may have had a definite influence over some of these stories that Howard was writing. So when we started to do our Conan illustrations, we started looking at things like that. We were trying, because Ruth and I never felt very comfortable illustrating Conan. It wasn't really our thing. We didn't feel we had anything to say about it. We didn't have anything to add to it. We looked at Frank Frazetta and felt, that's not what we do. Didn't really feel comfortable doing it. So we went back and looked at a ton of what was happening at his time and tried to find a way to capture something that would work for us. And we found that an awful lot of Conan is just Howard and the things he liked. And that's Bob Howard there doing that same kind of, Sandow kind of thing. And for us, Conan was a big question mark. So when we did illustrate Conan, we found we were most comfortable when we left him as a question mark, when we just threw him into shadow and you couldn't really nail him down too much. Just a sort of primal figure that kind of exists in the back of our minds. And that was how we were, kind of most able to be comfortable enough to do it. Now, we had a lot of different characters to do in the book we did, and that's why we were chosen to illustrate it, because we weren't associated with any particular character. But as you see here, again, we tended to turn Conan away to make sure that we weren't making him too specific. We wanted him to just sort of be a glyph, an icon within the larger illustrations we were doing, and we found that the technique worked for some of the other larger heroes that Howard did too, like Bran MacMorn, keeping that sense of mystery for ourselves. We were able to delineate most other things, but some of his heroic characters really seemed to make us a little uncomfortable when we had to nail them down too much. Now, for Dark Horse, we did this Conan pinup, and I think this was the only time Ruth and I felt comfortable actually drawing Conan, because we were able to get away from Howard completely, do something completely fanciful, completely fun, and not worry about any of the things that were probably expected of us for Conan, and came up with just something that we looked at and said, well, if this was on the cover of a comic book when I was 10, I would have wanted to read this.
Right. So we were able to do, the Conan that you come to think of as looking like Conan, whereas when we did the illustrations for the best of, we had to stick with the Conan that could sit in amongst the text, which isn't necessarily that Conan. So this was a freeing experience for us.
But as we moved through the book that we were illustrating, we had to have an approach that would sit comfortably for Conan and for boxing stories, which Howard wrote more boxing stories than anyone else in his career. And his scope was pretty wide. We did westerns for that particular book. And there was some horror stories. This was a kind of a Lovecraftian piece that he wrote called Black Stone. And we kept coming back to the... He did a lot of adventure. And in our designs, we kept trying to ignore and avoid the modern tropes that kind of have crept into Howard and going back to Howard's sources. Again, silent movies. This is from Fritz Lang's Siegfried. And when we read Howard's Valley of the Worm, it just seemed to us that Howard's character of Nord, whether he saw it or not, again, something in the water at the time, this is what we pictured, and we made sure to try to incorporate the feeling of that character as he would have known him into our illustration for that story. And in terms of things, just a little aside, in terms of things coming full circle, in the Dark Horse comics, we do this biographical strip, The Adventures of Two Gun Bob, and this is the very first one Dark Horse ever published. And in the strip, Bob was writing a letter about how he had gone to see John Gilbert's movie The Cossacks, and how much he liked Gilbert in the movie, and how he had previously not enjoyed Gilbert's pictures. And shortly after this comic ran, we got an email from Leatrice Joy Gilbert, his daughter. John Gilbert's daughter wrote us an email to tell us how much she enjoyed seeing her father talked about in a modern comic book. It was,
who knew she was a comic book, you know, Conan fan.
But yeah, but somehow she got her hands on it, and I was thinking it was pretty fascinating how I feel the silent movies kind of gave a lot of influence to Howard's work, and how that kind of came full circle almost 100 years later. We're being contacted by the children of, you know, one of the great silent stars, who almost like in a reversal, I don't think too many people today even know who John Gilbert was, but you know, everybody today in this field knows who Howard was, and she felt grateful that someone had mentioned her father, who had once been one of the biggest stars in the world. This is one of Mark's pieces, and I think Mark is also pulling from a similar well. There's a really Siegfried vibe going through this piece as well. If you see that, if you ever see that movie, Siegfried fights a giant dragon in the woods, and, you know, this has a lot of...
This is done. This is a piece of concept art for a Conan animation of Red Nails that was never produced. Absolutely going for a silent film. The glow of the silver screen type of feel with this. And this is another concept piece for that same film. And boy, this is Red Nails, the crawler from Red Nails, which, you know, Howard describes this reptilian horror that dwells in darkness, a slimy, horrible thing. And I thought I had designed it really nicely, but the client wanted an alligator. So I gave him Wally Gator. This is just a standalone illustration. You know, again, evolving the feeling of what I wanted to do with Conan. Now this is several pieces in a row here, just showing kind of the process of how I develop a piece. Again, when I received the assignment to do the Conan book, one of the stories is my personal favorite Conan story, Queen of the Black Coast. And just from memory, just to get the ball rolling, I was so buzzed to do this, I kind of tried to draw the ultimate scene in this, the climax, from memory. And we can go to the next one, Mike, please. And which was really off base. And then I, once I reread the story and took notes, I started refining it into something. This is the preliminary to the final, just refining, and then the final here, where I got rid of the dead natives and put in dead jackals instead, for the text. And it's just kind of a way a piece typically evolves from me. Same elements in general, but just playing around with the placement and getting them, trying to get the details as close as possible. Jim, did you want to?
You wanted to talk about the dust jacket.
Yeah, okay, well, this was the dust jacket. They did a drawing in which was placed a painting for the wraparound dust jacket for the first Conan volume that I developed in coordination with Jim and Ruth. They designed the book, and I drew this, and basically it's a black and white drawing of a ruined city, which doesn't have a lot of sale value in itself.
Which I believe is, I think I asked for that.
Yeah.
I just said, you know, instead of trying to draw, another Conan battle or something going on behind, I said, since you have Conan in your painting, let's do a background illustration that tries to capture his world, but also the idea of the immense antiquity of that.
How did such a good job of writing about these sloppy and ancient ruined cities?
Yeah, and you do such an awesome job of showing them.
And it has that kind of the parade has passed by feeling that, man, this place must have really been something once, but now it just sits there.
But again, then I have an original piece of art of a ruined city, which doesn't have a lot of sale value, so I decided, in that space where the painting was placed, okay, Mike, I developed a drawing of Conan, and then, okay, next one, and inserted it right in there.
Which I thought was amazing to take, because when I got this piece to design from, it just had a hole, just a square hole in the front of the piece, and he turned what had been just it's just a piece of process art for us, just to get a background on that dust jacket into an amazing illustration. Well, it would have made a great dust jacket in itself. This piece here is by John Watkiss, and this is a little bit of behind the scenes kind of thing on illustration that isn't anything most people think about and probably shouldn't, because it shouldn't be part of the experience of reading. But the business of illustration sometimes involves things that have nothing to do with the characters or the stories or even the book. And this was done for a book Ruth and I art directed of Howard's stories, Swordwoman. And it seemed to be a kind of a great way to... a lot of times people will say, why did they do this, or why did they do that? Well, here's one possible reason why some of that stuff happens. You want to describe something quickly?
Okay.
Anyone who hasn't read it?
So the book is a collection of the Dark Agnes stories that he wrote. She was Swordwoman, and then there was...
just her character.
Her character.
So they know what the thing is.
Yeah. And in this story... we meet Dark Agnes, and she's a little village, well, not little, but she's a village girl in the medieval era, and she's been pledged to be married to a guy that she really does not like and has not been very nice to her in the past, but her father's not going to let her out of it. And so she's dressed to be married, and they're going to have the ceremony, but she rebels and she stabs her her groom and splits, and she wanders and she runs out into the woods, and she doesn't know what's going to happen to her, but she's desperate to get away and start a new life.
The version of Runaway Bride.
Yes, with sword.
Now this painting, when we were art directing John Watkiss for this book, the way John wanted to work was essentially to have us describe to him in words what we wanted each piece to be, and then he would draw it. And he's in England, so he wasn't accessible to us to work with too closely, but we would go back and forth on the phone, and normally he would send a sketch before he did painting. And when I describe what we wanted here of her, maybe the next morning after all this has happened, coming into what's going to be a radically changed world for her, she's a very dangerous creature at this point, and she's still wearing the tatters of her wedding dress, and the morning sun is coming up through this forest, and she's got, again, a little bit of that kind of mad, silent movie heroine thing, where
I think you would know that you needed to take a step back from this woman if you came across this scene. And when he asked if he could go straight to finish on this and not show us any sketches. He said, I know exactly what you're looking for, but it's going to have to be a bit of a stream of consciousness painting in order to get that feeling. And so we said to go ahead. And when he turned this in, I was blown away. We both were. It was exactly what we wanted for the cover of that book.
Thrilled as much as we could imagine and what it would be like. It was so much better.
Oh, yeah. We just thanked him up one side and down the other and said, you've nailed it, because not only will this represent the work well, but statistically, more women than men buy books. I thought this painting would appeal to women. It looked like something men would want to read, too. It didn't exploit her in the typical kind of way. And when we turned the painting into Del Rey, the sales department came back and told us that this was completely unacceptable. Nobody was going to want this. The editor loved it. Now, the editor wasn't making the choices. The sales department was making the choices. Businessmen who had never read the stories, were unfamiliar with Howard, probably... You know, all they knew was the title, Sword Woman, and maybe Robert E. Howard, creator of Conan. So they got me on the phone and started describing what they wanted. They wanted her to have red hair. They wanted her to be wearing like a kind of an iron chainmail bikini. They wanted her, they wanted a lot of cleavage and, her directly threatening the reader. And so John was heartbroken. And I think with... kind of a half broken heart, he did this sketch and sent it back based on exactly what they asked for. And it's still nice, but the department there took his sketch and in Photoshop, oh, go back one. If you go back one more and then go ahead again, John's is still nicely composed. They took his sketch and cut it apart and put it in Photoshop. And if you go to the next one, they sent this back and said, this is what we want, because her sword had previously been obscuring her breasts, and we need to see both breasts. And John took this and he painted it up. So we sent this illustration in. Now, at this point, I'm on the phone with the editor, and I'm saying, this is Red Sonja. And Howard didn't create that character. That's a comic book character. This is all wrong for Dark Agnes, and they were thrilled. So I just started to panic. I thought, we're going to get blamed for this. People are going to buy this book and say, you know, Jim and Ruth Keegan are idiots for art directing the guy to draw this. And so we contacted Paradox. They contacted some attorneys because Paradox, the Robert E. Howard properties, they didn't own Red Sonja. And so after much arm twisting, they decided to put her back into a the what's this like? So they wanted her dressed like she's dressed in the story. Now he painted this directly on top of that last travesty you saw. He just added the clothes, and he's getting more and more impatient with this piece because it's lost everything he ever wanted in it. And they still now dealt the. The Robert E. Howard properties people are happy enough because she's wearing what she's described wearing later in the story. But the Del Rey people are very unhappy because she's not anything like the Red Sonja that they wanted. So John makes one more little change, and he puts chainmail over her chest. And the people at the sales department at Del Rey are finally conceding that, okay. And so we end up with this bastard child instead of this beautiful thing here, which is so elegant and lovely and tells so much story. We ended up, one more, with that. And that's the cover of the Sword Woman book as published. And I think the first day that was solicited online, the Robert E. Howard discussion groups filled up with, lists of people going, what in the hell is wrong with the people doing this book? Didn't they bother to read the stories? And the answer is yes and no. Everyone involved in making the book read the stories except for the guys who were able to make those guys jump through hoops. And I think an awful lot of times when you see an illustration that just, it's like, oh, this illustrator must really suck. well, maybe the illustrator doesn't suck. Maybe the guy he's working for does. And no one's ever going to know that. And I felt it was a tragedy that so many... I've heard people say that they picked up the book, looked at the cover, and that I don't like this illustrator. I don't like this character. I don't want to read this thing and put it back. And... you know, I can't explain it other than I guess the sales guys had seen some sort of list of things, and all they knew was, oh, there's this, if you're doing a barbarian woman, a sword woman, she looks like Red Sonja, Bridget Nielsen in a chainmail bikini. And yeah, what are you going to do? But other times you get a chance to work under much better conditions. Now, these are three pulp covers that Mark Schultz sent me when we started working on the Tales of Science Fantasy book for the Robert E. Howard Foundation. Now, the way things work there is the exact opposite of the situation I had at Del Rey. The editor of the book has given me complete artistic control of how those covers look from front to back. And when Mark came onto the project, I just gave the same to Mark. I said, whatever you want to paint, whatever you see in this text, let's go for it. And Mark sent me these pulps because this was the feeling he wanted to get from the cover. And he asked if he went this direction, if I'd have any problem with that, and I certainly didn't. Was there something about this particular period that made you think, like, of science fiction? When most people think of science fiction, they think of something a lot more tech-heavy, and you were going back to a more romantic
fiction. It was, Almanrick was written, I think, by Howard, kind of at the behest of his agent to fulfill a need for an interplanetary romance. He believed that was a market that Howard could exploit, and the heyday of interplanetary romance was up to the 1920s. These are all books from the teens and 20s that stylistically were of that period. So I wanted to incorporate that feeling, that stylistic tendency into this book to reflect kind of that, at that point when he wrote this, at least a decade-old aesthetic that he's kind of aiming at, I think, with Almanrick.
Okay. And this sort of thing, even though it isn't Conan, even though it has nothing, you know, really to do with that character, we wanted to talk about this end of the business a little bit, so that when you look at your favorite Howard illustrator, you kind of get an idea of it being more than just the fan. When the fan reads a story, when I was young and I would read one of these stories, I had very precise ideas of what it was I was seeing, and but oftentimes there's practical things that will change that, like we were talking about with Greg Manchess, how Conan wasn't his thing when he was young. So it's not going to have necessarily all the same fetishes that everyone's used to. It doesn't seem to sit in continuity quite right for them because they're accustomed to a certain thing. But in this case, this is a great example of an artist, I think, being given a really free hand. And this was the first sketch that Mark sent back. And do you have anything to add about the sketch?
No.
Okay. And this was the cover as finally designed, which we did as a wraparound. And I thought it really did capture that kind of 1920s period. And one of the things Mark asked for in the title treatment, and I completely agreed with, was that we get kind of an Al St. John feeling to it. And in my opinion, St. John was the best title designer, like probably ever. And so I looked through, if you can hold it, if you can go back one, I looked through a bunch of old pulps that St. John had done the titles for. And I found one, I think it was called Saddle Law. It was a novel called Saddle Law, and I was able to swipe his S from that to give it the the appropriate feeling of that period. And but you couldn't sell that cover to a major publisher because it comes from a different sensibility, And it was the same when we did our own work for a publisher that let us have a free hand. Now, Ruth and I are both big fans of the Pulps and the Pulp artists, and we used the opportunity to be able to create a kind of a piece of art that no one is ever going to hire us to do in the mainstream. And so when they gave us the Spicy Adventure book to do, we have tons of this stuff. One of our favorite approaches is that woman being menaced by disembodied arm theme that you see on so many of these pulps. So we decided to go in that direction, and we hired a model to come in. And this was an interesting case where we had very clear ideas of what we wanted. But this gal came in, and we must have shot, with digital cameras, you can just shoot. We must have shot over 200 or so pictures that day, and it was going on for a while, and we just weren't happy with any of the things we were getting that we had sketched out, and we were starting to think that maybe we were going in the wrong direction. And in our very last shot, and it wasn't until even we looked through them, she had completely changed her position and did this, which had, I thought, a genuine air of menace to it. So we went with this, and using the text from the book, the girl in the story is a blonde. We worked out our drawing, and just a quick. And because we didn't have to go through the businessmen, these are just a few you can go through quickly. We were able to just plow through this painting straight to finish from just that quick line sketch. And because we were able to take it all the way to finish, we were able to do our own titles. It bothers me that the hardbacks are a different shape than pulps. So I kept thinking, man, it's too bad it's a little shorter. I could really have nailed that look. But tried to design a pulp-style title treatment. And as we did these things for them, we were able to have a lot of fun doing it. I mean, this kind of book, you're not going to see in a Barnes & Noble looking that way anymore, because everyone's convinced it's antique, it doesn't sell, and I can't explain it. Here we had a free hand with the publisher to try to recreate one of those old paperbacks where we were even able to add the line under Howard's name, famous creator of Conan. Remember how all those books always found a way to put the word Conan on the cover? They always had like a little banner in the corner. And El Barak always struck us as like an old serial type adventure hero, and you did this little reminiscent of a movie poster that might have been for a chapter adventure back in the day. We named all his characters and credits at the bottom. But sometimes you get an interesting situation out of a little too much freedom. When we did this piece, it was done for Illustrated World of Robert E. Howard, and it doesn't illustrate any particular story, but we were asked to do an El Barak illustration. And El Barak was Howard's desert adventure hero, a kind of a combination of Chinese Gordon and Lawrence of Arabia and Richard Francis Burton. So we just tried to come up with an image that captured the sort of thing that was in those stories. Not only didn't we have any editor or art director, no one ever even asked what we were thinking. And we took this completely to finish. And we were the designers of the project as well. And we put the whole book together, and a whole bunch of other artists contributed to it. Mark contributed, Gary Gianni, Mike Mignola, Scott Gustafson. It was just full of these paintings. And when we finally sent it to Howard Properties, they looked at it and said it was a wonderful picture, a wonderful book, but they were unfortunately going to have to find a replacement for this picture, because it was 2004 and we had just recently invaded Iraq. And they felt that it was politically inappropriate to show a Westerner standing over a pile of dead Arabs. I literally spent 5 hours on the phone that morning with them before I was able to convince them that they could run it. I guess it was a good thing in the end that our picture got published, but I guess we ran into the same problem that John Watkiss did with his Swordwoman piece. Had they been able to stop us sooner, maybe it would have been a drawing of Elbarak in a chainmail bikini. Fortunately, I wonder if they hadn't had the ability to have him redraw it, if we might have ended up with a better cover. And I look at the covers Frank Frazetta did, and I remember that Elsbrock de Camp had said on a few occasions that he didn't like them. He didn't like those Frazetta covers that ran on his book. And I guess was he the editor of that series? But he obviously didn't have enough power to kill those covers. But had he the power to kill those covers, we wouldn't have any of those images by Frank Frazetta that we, you know, all called out as our favorites. And I think sometimes we're lucky at the things that do slip through. And I often wonder if maybe all of our favorite Conan illustrations, or just illustrations in general, are the ones that never actually made it to the publication. So it's just something to think about, that maybe there's somewhere, maybe even just in the back of someone's head, was a design that simply was not allowed to work by the actual publisher. And we were just going to ask if you had any questions about anything.
I'm just curious if about a couple of powered female characters like Juliet and Valeria. Do you guys have any favorite depictions by any of those in Mark or any of those?
Well, when you take Mark out of it, that's kind of narrowing. I don't know.
No one leaps to mind for me.
For example, Jim Dunn did a good job with Valeria. And I also thought Gary Smith did a good job.
I like his Valeria a lot.
Yeah, I thought that was good. I don't know much about this fellow, Brom, this artist Brom, but he's got a cover of the Black Coat. But I thought that he's got a chapter through the sinister aspect. It kind of gets lost sometimes, so they turn into just a barbarian woman or something like that. I just thought the look of her there, he did a good job in the concept. Sort of sinister aspect that sometimes does it just look for fair.
Now, Brown is great. He's a school and to himself.
I thought he did a great job capturing that look.
Oh, absolutely. Even some of the things you bring up is an interesting point. When we started to talk about and think about the history of Conan illustration and Howard illustration, we realized that, you know, any group of guys like you probably know way more than we do about the history of this material.
Jim and I did not grow up reading Howard or fantasy or reading comic books or anything. I mean, I guess you did, Mark.
I did, but I'm still pretty ignorant compared to a lot of people.
I mean, the fandom of Pulps and of Howard, their drawers are bottomless for some of this stuff. And even today at lunch, when we were talking a little about this, questions were brought up, oh, do you have this illustrator or that illustrator? And in some cases, they were guys we'd never thought about or heard of. And we just realized that this is a broad subject, that everybody does have their favorites. It's a little, you know, close to impossible to really cover completely. But it is, as we were saying, impossible also to ignore Frank, and you have to see that as a balancing point for everything. But Valeria, as you point out, there's a not a minor character, but a supporting character, and then that takes off in a whole new direction of you know, illustrative depictions.
I just want
last one.
I just wanted to mention you had shown those wonderful spicy logos, which you follow for Spicy Mystery, Spicy Detective. For anyone who's interested, those were designed by a wonderful, the best logo designer ever named Irish Ness, who did design the lettering, the marble lettering on the Central New York Post Office and the Central Manhattan Library, but also designed the classic Superman logo on almost all of the DC Comics logos over the years. And there's a blog called Dial B for Blog, which has a 10-part biography and history of Irish Knapp's work.
Irish Knapp?
Irish Knapp.
Okay.
S C C-H-N-A-P-P. But if you want to find out about the man who designed those wonderful spicy logos and the Superman logo and such, dial E for block.
Well, thanks. And that's another great example of what we were talking about with the bottomless drawers of information in the room and the endless directions all of this stuff can take you. And it never stops being fascinating. So thanks for that.
No one's ever improved on his logos. They're just so perfect.
They are.
All right. Big hand for...